We repaired trucks and things.
In what part, where were you repairing trucks?
In Europe.
In Europe, okay. What particular places?
England, France, Belgium, Germany.
Oh, you've been around then, huh?
Yeah.
Okay, good. Bud?
I was a Navy cook for 2 years in the hospital in Palm Beach, California.
Okay. Avery?
I was in a night armored infantry division. With my company that captured the bridge at Remagen.
Nice. Okay. Ed?
Well, I've got practice right here at Boone Academy as a private. And I ought to end that up by saying I came out a lieutenant colonel.
Well, that's good.
That's a good coming out.
But actually, what I did was all underground. Practically everything's underground, and it was top secret.
I see.
And I can't reveal too much of it even today, because I don't think it's been declassified.
After all these years?
Well, some people every once in a while, I think that somebody suggested that I ought to write a book.
Yep.
And when I think about writing a book, I have to think that maybe I ought to say something about some things I know.
Yeah.
But every once in a while, it comes out in the paper about some things I know that somebody has spoken about, and they're declared out of order.
Out of order.
So I'm afraid.
What secrets can they have after 50 years, though? You'd think they'd be...
I don't know. There's still some things that...
Really? Really? I mean, atomic energy, maybe? I don't know. Okay.
I was a personnel officer in the Navy in a factory in Cincinnati, which was also secret but has been declassified. And we made the proximity fuse.
Okay, good. And Dick?
I don't know why I'm here. After 6 years and 2 months in the Navy, I got across neither ocean. I asked for nothing. It was great. But I served at the whim of the Navy. Whatever they wanted, I was available, but they didn't see fit to send me across.
I see, okay. Alan, where were you?
England, most of the time, well, after I went overseas, was the 8th Air Force with a fighter squadron.
Okay. Bill?
Well, I started out with about 4 years, a little better, in Camp Croft, South Carolina, in an infantry replacement training center, and then eventually joined the 70th Division and landed in Marseille and ended up in the Calsas, the Saarbrücken area.
Albert, where?
I was a pilot in World War II, and I was stationed in quite a few different places. In this country here, I went from Biloxi, Mississippi, to Cleveland, Ohio, to San Antonio, Santa Ana, California, Hemet, California, San Bernardino, and then Douglas, Arizona, and Fort Wayne, Indiana, before I got overseas. Over there, I was at Chittagong, India, and Kharagpur, and then in Mission of Burma.
Burma.
So they let us
I see.
Out and we come home.
I see. Okay. And Bob?
Well, I was in the same kind of an outfit as Ken Moore. I started out in officer candidate school and got my commission in, of all things, anti-aircraft. I was preparing to shoot Albert down, see? But the ordnance department decided that they needed instructors at Aberdeen Proving Grounds, and I spent a year teaching technical ammunition and explosives and associated, in those days, rocketry was super secret. And several times I had to burn the film after I showed it. And lo and behold, I ended up over in Europe in ordnance, doing similar things, but then organizing an office in charge of preparing ordnance material, meaning trucks, anything movable that was in the ordnance department, preparing it for reshipment to the Pacific theater. That's when I thought I was going to get a trip around the world, because I volunteered to join an outfit that was going to go through the Mediterranean, the Suez, and on to the Pacific Theater. But the doggone Japs quit too soon, and lo and behold, I had to come back to this country.
I beat him out. I did go all the way around the world.
Yeah, good. Okay, let's go to the next question. What was the best part of your service? We'll start with Bob over here.
Oh, my goodness.
The best part.
Well, it wasn't all that bad, really. I married my beautiful wife while I was stationed at Aberdeen Proving Grounds, and we started out life together living in Baltimore.
I see.
That was an education in itself. I guess the other best thing might be the fact that I was stationed for a long time right in the city of Paris. I saw all of Paris from the catacombs underneath the city to the top of the Eiffel Tower and everything in between. That was very interesting, very rewarding. I've been back since to check it out again. It's not the same.
Albert, what was your best, what was the best part of the war done for you?
Well, I had several points that I enjoyed. One, of course, the trip around the world. They also, I enjoyed flying. In fact, I got my private license before I got into the service. And then during the flying training out the West Coast, it was, I just enjoyed that. And then one other thing was coming home on the boat from India, we come across the Pacific, and the weather was beautiful. We had there was only eight of us Air Force officers were on board the ship, and we all had staterooms. We could come out on the deck whenever we wanted to, and just enjoy it. The other thing that I enjoyed, of course, is when I was taking my transition training down in Austin, Texas, my wife and son came down and spent 4 months with me down there. I hadn't seen my son for a year, but our wife either one for a year, but they spent 4 months down there, and we really had a good time.
Good. Bill, what was your best part of
it? I guess probably the best part of it was when I was in Camp Croft, South Carolina, all right, because it wasn't quite as good as that after I got overseas in the infantry. I did enjoy the weather down there, but don't let anybody tell you that it don't get cold down in South Carolina. The temperature won't get as cold, but it gets cold.
Right.
And, I did spend, Shelby was down there with me for about 6 months, I guess. I believe that was the year we were married. I can't remember for sure. My memory's not too good that far back. But the one thing that wasn't very good when I was in there, I was in 41, and the day they bombed Pearl Harbor, I was thinking just before that I was going to be out in April, but I didn't get out.
Al, what was the best part of your service?
Well, I guess probably when I was waiting to go to school in the fall of 41, I was taken to Las Vegas, Nevada, and they put me on MP duty, bam, bam.
How about you, Dick? What was the best part of your service?
Well, I was going to say getting discharged. But actually, the rapid advancement in rate. I was on a very small ship, a little 136-foot minesweeper. I only had three officers and about a crew of 32. And I went on as a seaman, and I came off that ship in the petty officer first class. Well, I thought that was pretty damn good.
Well, I think having a small office that worked well, but also I think surviving having three women roommates that we called girls at that time, with one bedroom and one closet, would only could do this with uniforms.
Ed, what was the best part of your service?
I think the best part of my service was a fast advancement in rank.
Oh, yeah, okay.
In the first place, I was taken in as a private. And I was assigned, while awaiting another assignment, I was assigned at Fort Devens. And they put me to work choosing and making choices of sizes of women's underwear. And I had a corporal. They had a corporal who would address me this way: "All right, you guys," he'd say, "now you measure the waist for underclothing by beginning with your arm, and from here to here is small, from here to here is medium, from there to here is large." Then my first promotion was to corporal. I skipped PFC. I don't know whether it came because of my knowledge of anyway, I skipped PFC, and I skipped all the rest of the enlisted ranks and went to officer school. And very shortly after, just before officer school, I happened to meet one of the new second lieutenants. And I said, "Hey," I said, "can you tell me He said, "Where I'm going to go from here?" And he said, "Soldier, I want you to understand, you do not address a commissioned officer as hey." Well, anyway, I got my appointment, and I then made second lieutenant overseas, and I skipped captain. I was never a captain. Then I went on to major, and then, of course, we got into the heat of things. And because of the background that I had in foreign languages, I went from first lieutenant to lieutenant colonel.
Avery, what was your best experience, best part of your experience?
I think the best part of the war was when the war ended.
Okay.
And I don't think there's any question, but my happiest day was the day I got discharged.
Good. Mike, what was your
Well, I had 2 years of looking around California. Had a good time at it.
Good. Good. And, Ken?
I had a kind of good experience. I was assigned at the beginning, when I got into the service in August of 41, to an ordnance plant. I had a old model A Ford that I bought for $22, and I was in the hospital in Aberdeen, and they told me to go to Lake City Ordnance Plant. I didn't know where Lake City was, but my family was living in Ohio, so I drove out there in this car. We found it was near Kansas City. It's not near St. Louis. In fact, it's near President Truman's hometown. But this was a big place where they made ammunition, and they had about 3,000 acres, and they had horse guards. And the horse guards, the horses were ridden by broken-down cowboys, guys that couldn't get through the physical for the draft. They did that. And the stable sergeant was a rodeo rider, and he was illiterate completely. And I got to be very friendly with him. And this was my childhood ambition. I wanted to be a cowboy. And I rode a lot. I eventually got the best horse there that I rode every day. And I used to help this cowboy break horses. He would break them first, and then I would work them later. And then he'd go down and sell them as saddle horses to these rubes from the east who would think they would be good. But that finished when they decided to replace us with overage and grave people. We were too young for that.
I see. Okay, now let's go back to the opposite side of things. What was the worst experience of your wartime experience, Bob?
17 weeks of officer candidate school. There was a bird dog right behind you all the way with a horse whip.
Okay. Albert, what was your worst experience?
Well, I was sworn in to the Air Force in August of 1942. And they sent me home to wait for to be called up when they wanted me. So in the meantime, I got married, and we had an apartment down there in Camden. And then in March, I got my orders from Portland to report to Fort Dix on March 6, 1943. Well, it just so happened that I was in a nursing home with the mumps, and they'd settled over. And that's about the worst thing ever. The only other thing was being away from home, my family, young family, of course. And then our second son was born in September of 1945, and I was still over in India at the time, and I never saw him until he was almost 7 months old.
I see. Bill?
Well, I'm just tossing up a couple of things here, wondering, well, the worst thing was when I was thinking about getting out in April, and they bombed Pearl Harbor, and I didn't, or whether it was after I got hit overseas, laying there wondering whether the next bomb was going to hit me or somebody else.
Britain's about the same way. You're supposed to get out in January.
Alan?
Well, I think one of the positions I held for quite a long time before I went overseas and afterwards, after I went school was low on the line working on planes. One of my jobs, anytime there was a crash of me and about six more, no matter what we'd done, we had to go. No matter why or what time, the day or night or anything else. A lot of it was too much.
Okay. Dick?
My worst experience, I think, was riding that little wooden minesweeper. that was the roughest thing, up, down, yaw, roll, everything. And the only thing that I can think of that rode worse than that was probably on an old Liberty ship. If anybody in the Merchant Marine, those things were wild.
Well, I didn't have any really bad experiences, but one was, that I could mention was right in officers' training school. They insisted that everybody who played an instrument should send for their instrument no matter what we protested. So I sent for my trumpet, and I hadn't played for 5 years, and I discovered I didn't know how to play anymore. And so I just had a horrible time every time there was band practice until finally I hit on the day of so-called graduation when Captain McAfee came and all. We marched, and the other girl that played the trumpet played it very beautifully. And afterwards, people said, oh, you played together so well, it sounded just like one trumpet.
Ed?
Well, I think the thing that affected me the worst, of course, being in World War II, we all didn't see death, I'm sure. But the thing that affected me the worst was one day when we were retrieving a tank from the battlefield. And it was on a tank retriever, and that's a very heavy machine. And if you've been abroad, you know that the buildings are built right on the sidewalks. When you come out of your front door, you're on the sidewalk. And on this particular day, I was just across the road, and the streets are very narrow too. And it's very difficult for a tank retriever to make a corner, especially with a tank on it. So I was on the other side of the street, and all at once, this little girl, about 4 years old, came charging out of her door and jumped onto the sidewalk and started to go across the street, just in time to be hit by the tank retriever. And she fell under the wheels, and all there was a tremor.
Okay, Avery?
I think probably the worst. Well, there's a couple of things. The worst experience was about halfway across the bridge when the Germans set off the demolition charges to blow it up. Fortunately, only part of the charges went, so we made it across the bridge. A few people did. The other thing that really bothered me was some of the sights we saw when we liberated some of the prison camps.
Okay,
but I'm really lucky. I have no bad experiences.
Kent, do you have any bad experiences?
I was also lucky. I remember going across on the boat trying to evade, and that was a rocky kind of thing. And I remember the lostness when you got out. You know, what am I going to do next? Everything was, you didn't know what to do. That wasn't so easy, but that's about it.
We'll start over with you, Ken, again. What contact did you have with home during your service in the war? What contact did you have at home? Just mail?
Email. Lots of email.
Okay. Any other contact with home? Letters or anything like that?
Well, letters. Yeah,
letters. Letters. Did you have any leaves, too, or anything like that?
Well, not when you're overseas, but I had leave home, yeah.
Okay. How about you,
Bud?
What kind of contact?
About the same thing.
Yeah?
The same thing.
Avery?
I had no leave. After I left the United States, there was no leave until I got back.
When
I got back, I got discharged.
When did you leave the United States?
In January of 44. 44? January 1st, 44.
Yep. How about you, Ed? What contact do you have with
My
you?
Only contact was with V-mail.
V-mail, yeah.
But fortunately, I could sign. You know, you had an initial of the stamp was.
Right.
By a commissioned officer.
Right.
I could sign my own letters and not have anybody read them.
I see.
Well, I was in this country, so I could go home and we could ride on the trains at half price, so I rode a lot of trains sitting on my suitcase. And my most exciting experience was going home on a bomber, hitching a ride on a bomber and being able to look out the front. And then Ken and I had lots of email going back and forth because we really courted by mail. Right, Ken?
Yeah. Okay. Dick?
Mine would be V-mail and letters and so forth.
Yep.
My mother sold our house when I was in the service. She went to California. So, yeah, just letters.
Mm-hmm. You wrote to me, you old thing.
How about you, Al?
Well, I guess you could say the mail most of the time. I've been 4 years, three days.
3 days, huh?
On the West Coast, I managed to get back here to spend 3 days.
Mm-hmm. Bill?
Well, I had a few leaves when I was in South Carolina, but after I left that, it was
mailed. How about you, Al?
Is that the one, the supportive one, number four? Is this number four question?
No, number three. What kind of contact do you have with home?
Oh. Well, as I said before, my wife was home there while I was in the service. She had the baby, and she lived with her parents for all the time that I was gone. And her mother helped take care of the baby, and she went back to school and spent a year in school, graduated, and I couldn't ask for anything better than that.
Yeah. How about you, Bob?
I was quite fortunate. For the 3 years that I was in, I managed to make it home to Bethel here three times. So. Before I went overseas, I came home with a delay en route when I transferred from North Carolina to Aberdeen Proving Grounds, and then I got another leave before I went overseas. Following overseas duty, I got home again before I got discharged.
We hear there was a widespread black market of all kinds of privileges and goods that were available to people who had the right connections. And so there was some question about how much sacrifice people on the home front did for the war. Did you believe the people back home were fully supporting your efforts? Did you believe that? That seemed to be the case in your case?
Yeah. Didn't know anything of it.
Okay. How about you, Bud?
You sure did, as far as I'm concerned.
Okay.
Yeah, I know if you hitchhiked away, no one ever refused your ride.
Right?
Okay. The car went by, they'd pick you up.
Peter, in service uniform?
Yeah.
The service uniform did it every time, right?
Yeah.
How about you, Avery? Did you think that people back home were fully supporting the war effort?
Oh, yeah, I can't hear it.
Okay. How about you, Ed? Yeah.
Well, I had full faith in the people back home.
Yep.
There was no question about that.
I
didn't have the same faith in the people abroad.
Yeah.
On our side.
Yeah.
Particularly.
Yeah.
I'm not talking about the enemy.
Yeah.
But the number of chests that were stored when we shipped from the United States to arrive in Europe.
Yeah.
When we got them in Europe, they were open, many of them, with bars, and the locks were broken, and nothing was in them except possibly a sock.
Yeah. Okay. That's interesting, though. How about you, Gwen?
Well, we actually participated in the support. One of my jobs was to get people to buy war bonds that kind of thing. And of course, we were rationed just like everybody else.
Yep.
We rode the streetcar, car, that was for sure.
Okay. Dick?
I should guess that people supported us. I never heard otherwise as such.
How about you, Al?
Well, the only time that I didn't think they were doing a very good job was when, about the time we were getting ready for D-Day, and we were missing tires for some of the fighter planes. We had one time, I think, on the base out of about 50-some-odd, we had over 10 grounded because we didn't have tires enough to go around.
Hmm. How about you, Bill?
As far as I know, they were
doing all right. How about you?
I don't think they was already.
Any black market at work or any special deals or anything like that? Okay. How about you, Bob?
Well, I saw a little of both.
Yeah, okay. Can you give us a little insight here?
I realized the people at home were undergoing rationing with several things, and one probably the only time in my life that I can remember that my father-in-law spoke to me, and I looking down his nose a little bit, was, "You took a pretty big slice of butter, fella." Came in the black market thing. One night in southern France, I stomped a GI with a 6x6 truck loaded right to the hilt, just all he could get up the hill with, and it was plumb full of Lucky Strike cigarettes.
Okay. Did you have any contact with any of the great military leaders or commanders in World War II? Did you ever see them or have any kind of insight into their behavior? Ken, did you ever see any of the big commanders or any of the great commanders during this period?
Just the head of the services of supply or some,
okay,
some guy.
Okay. How about you, Bud? Did you ever see any of the biggies? No? Avery?
A couple of them. Patton and Eisenhower.
You saw them in action, didn't you? Where'd you
we
see
weren't
them?
Buddies, but I...
No. On what circumstances did you see them? How did you happen to see them?
It was after the war, and yep. They were visiting troops.
Oh, I see. Visiting troops. You didn't see them during the war, though?
No.
Okay. How about you, Ed? Did you see anything?
After the war that Patton got killed.
That's right.
Big, very close to where I was stationed.
Oh, yeah. Big commanders or any of the big generals? Or?
I had contacts with Patton. Contacts with Hodges, contacts with Montgomery, and contact with, who was the other guy? Seems like there was another one.
Yes.
But I, quite regularly.
You saw them all, did you? Yeah, you saw Montgomery and all, yeah, okay.
I reported to them.
Oh, I see, oh yeah, well good.
I can't remember who the other one was, there was another one. Right. But I used to report to Hodges, Patton, Montgomery,
Bradley. Okay, good. How about you, Gwen?
Only Captain McAfee, the captain in the Navy, is quite high up, and she was probably the highest up woman officer.
I see.
But none of the big names.
None of the big names, okay. How about Dick? Did you ever see any of the big names?
No. Big names.
Okay. How about you, Alan? Did you ever see the big names? No. Bill?
I just read them in the paper, that's okay.
I see. How about you, Alba?
I was fortunate. I was stationed in Conzie headquarters of Europe in the little town of Paris, France. And General Eisenhower and De Gaulle were both there frequently. This was right after the war ended.
I see.
I saw both of them on several occasions, but my closest encounter was with General Eisenhower. I had confiscated a bicycle to assist me in getting around the city. And I came out from breakfast one morning, pedaling like mad around the corner of Avenue Kleber to get back to the office, or get to the office on time. Just as General Eisenhower and his party were leaving their hotel, and I was about to run him over with a bicycle. All I did was be his famous grin. And I brought the two-wheeler to a stop. So.
I see. Yeah. What can you say about the food in the during the war? Ken, what can you say about the food? Anything particular about the food that you remember?
Passable, we had to survive. Yeah. I remember it unusual.
How about the sleeping conditions?
Quite terrible. I wasn't really in the field.
No.
Like guys in the infantry were.
Okay. How about you, Bud? Anything?
Well, I had
to
move to Warden Hospital. Dogs and top bunk.
I see. Okay. How about you, Avery? Food was.
I've had that one.
Okay. What about sleeping conditions?
I've had that one.
Any special stories that you want to tell us about?
No, I guess.
Sleeping conditions? Oh, okay. How about you, Ed?
Well, I slept on the ground a lot. I had one experience, which I thought was probably the only one that I might have experienced, and that is I slept in the bed of Wallace Warfield Simpson.
Well,
and that the reason for that was not with her. Simpson lived in what we used to call right next to Albert Hall, if you know a lot.
Right.
Albert Hall.
Right.
Okay, right behind Albert Hall is Onslow Gardens. And at the time that the Prince was going out with Wallace Warfield Simpson and made that famous speech about, I gave up the king of England to be, to
the
woman I love.
Right.
Right after that, we had the Blitz were coming down in London. We had first the V1s and the V2s. We could always tell where the V1s were because you could hear the little putt, 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 just like a lawnmower.
Oh, yeah.
And you could see a little flame behind them at night, just about that long. The minute that flame would go off and the putt, putt would go off, you knew it was coming down somewhere near you if you were under it. Well, she had so many of those bombs that fell on Onslow Gardens that it drove her out of it. So when she went out, just the day before she went out, actually, one of the bombs, one of those V1s or V2s, I don't know which one it was, hit her place. And it blew the place all to smithereens, except for there was a part of the ceiling that was still hanging. And I had just come in to be in the Eisenhower headquarters. And they were looking for a place for me to have. And so they said, we know where it is. So they went down to the Onslow Gardens and they got Wallace Warfield Simpson's, the remaining of what she had. But we put a little bunk just under the on the roof, under the roof, so that I at least would have a shelter in case it rained. And that was my best bet, my best bet.
We ate what we cooked, and as usual in a group of women, one woman was a very good cook, outstanding cook. Two of us were sort of middling, and one was terrible cook. So that was how it went, and I was lucky, I thought, because I got a bottom bunk.
Bottom bunk, okay. How about you, Dick?
I thought the food was pretty good. I spent a lot of time in the receiving station in Boston, and they had a reputation for cooking there. It would be like in a big hotel in New York. It was great. I had no complaints on that. I didn't have too many complaints about shipboard food. Small ship, one guy doing the cooking, he did all right.
Sleeping conditions?
Sleeping on the ship beat the hell out of guys being in the ground.
Yep.
I thought that was good.
Yep. Okay. How about you, Al?
Well, most of the time I thought the food was good, except for I guess it was just started just before D-Day for some unknown reason. The crop of the Brussels sprouts, I guess, had just come on the market. About 3 months ago, we had the Brussels sprouts mutton. The main diet, I didn't get
it. Still like Brussels sprouts?
No.
How about you, Phil?
The Brussels sprouts sound like spam.
Spam bella.
I ate pretty well when I was in Camp Croft in the States here because I get to be pretty good buddies with the mess sergeant. It really helps out to know who's doing the cooking. But I guess I'd be along with Avery. After I get overseas, I've eaten better most anyway.
How about sleeping?
Well, after you watch 2 hours on, 2 hours off, for about 3 or 4 nights, you get so you can sleep standing up.
Albert, how about the food?
Well, while we were in training in stateside, we ate fairly well. Fed the cadets pretty good. When they went overseas, we were living in bashes, which were nothing but open side tents, really, and we had cots to sleep on, and no mosquito netting or anything like that, and our meals consisted of sea rations. Now, those are different meals put up in little small boxes about that wide, about that high, and about that thick, just like your cereal comes in nowadays. They had different meals, but every month we'd send a plane down to Calcutta to get a load of, a case load of those meals, and there was a surplus of them, so we could take a choice, and what we didn't want, we just threw away. But we lived out of those little up on the cots.
Yeah.
In an open, what was it, an open tent, really, a basher with leaves, branches for roof, and there was plenty of mud there, too.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Under the wet.
How about you, Bob?
Well, the only time that I remember bad food was Billy Goat stew for a week of 10 days in a row and off the candidate school. And as a result, I was deathly sick. That's the only, that's probably the one horror I have about officer candidate school that sticks with me the most. But the rest of the time, I don't recall that I could really complain about the grouse.
Did any of you make lifelong friends in the service? You did, Ed? Tell us about that a little bit.
Well, I had two in particular. One I worked with underground to try to trick the Germans.
Yeah.
And we did. And he appreciated, I guess, what I had contributed to it. Mm-hmm. And we were friends while I was there in Belgium. And following the war, after I came home, it was about 3 or 4 years later, when he had the birth of his one and only son, and he named him after me.
Well. Anybody else have some lifelong friends they made in the service?
Yeah, the friends that I still write to, and I haven't seen her for some years, but she, we did get together a few times. And another friend that we got together, but she has since died.
I see, okay. What is your most vivid single memory? Anybody have your most vivid single memory of the World War, World War II? Bob, you have something?
Well, I was thinking about that today, Stan. I guess I was thinking about these people that go on tours of Europe, and they seem to get a good impression of Germany. Those people should have seen it when it was just a pile of rubble from end to end.
Yeah.
That was very impressive. The city of Aachen, Germany, I came upon one morning, alone in a jeep. I was as hungry as all get out. I just couldn't find anybody with any grub. And as I looked out over the city of Aachen, I couldn't see anything that stood up over 6 feet tall. And it was, the whole city was made of red brick. And I think that probably stuck with me as much as anything.
Anybody else have a
good
memory?
I had one, and it stayed with me forever, even though today, and that is the concentration camp at Dachau. Mm-hmm. That was a terrible.
Anybody else have
anything? I think the thing that struck me the worst, Stan, when I first got over there and we were moving up towards the front line to get close enough to hear the shells come, and we're seeing these people moving out of their little houses with everything that they could carry, either on their back or in their little cart, and going and not knowing where they were going, or anything, just to get away from those German shells that were coming in.
Anybody else have any?
I have a light one.
Yep.
There was the Ohio River flooded, and the commanding officer from downtown and my commanding officer from the factory went out in a rowboat, and we figured that the only time those two Navy officers, Navy officers, ever got in a boat.
Yes.
The time when the war ended.
Yes.
That was a very vivid time. They were shooting off guns every which way.
Yep.
I remember that.
Yeah.
Yeah. I guess that's one
memorable time.
Memorable time. Anybody have any other particular memories when the war ended? That they had some particular memory of how it ended? Maybe we can turn. Oh, you have something, Dick?
Huh?
No. You got something you want to tell us?
Well, yeah. The day Japan surrendered, I was on a ship going through the Panama Canal.
Yeah.
And we were coming the right way.
Yeah.
But you see all these troop ships going out the other way, and we'd sit there and yell at them. And
yep.
Give them a hard time.
Yep.
But it was the first time on that ship that the captain said, "I haven't seen you steer this ship yet. Get up here and steer." And I said, "I don't know anything about steering in a canal." But I learned.
Yeah. Does anybody in the audience have any questions of the panel?
I'd like to ask Al, what kind of aircraft did you have?
We flew the C-47 and the C-46. I flew the C-46 overseas, but I was checked out in both of them.
Yeah.
comments from the audience? So, anybody got anything else to say?
I wondered if any of the rest of the panel here went on with the service after they came out of the war.
Did anybody go on and act in the service?
Yeah, I did. I was assigned, I had several assignments with the War Department, well, not the War Department at that time,
yep.
The Department of Defense now.
Yeah.
But I was assigned at the Washington, D.C. in the Pentagon. And during the time I was assigned at the Pentagon, I met with General Alger over here. And General Alger was in charge of the division that had to do with the WACS. And I was assigned to the Office of Foreign Liaison with all the foreign officers in there. And we were both side by side on the E ring, which is the outside ring, on the fifth floor. We could look over Washington. And the only one that had the natural light, except for the A ring, which is in the center. Yeah, everything else was just artificial light.
I see, wow. Other comments? Some of the wives?
I'd like to answer that.
Oh, yeah, one more down.
I'd like to answer a little more about that KP.
Okay. Let's hear about that.
KP was, I was on KP, as they say, it's in alphabetical order, and I was always the first on all of the lists. Two A's, but I only had to do that while I was in the United States. When I got overseas, I was assigned to a group, a recon group, reconnaissance and information, and we were on 24-hour call and were exempt from guard duty in KP.
May I add something about
yeah.
KP?
Yeah.
I never had KP, but I was the only officer. I didn't have any troops with me when I went overseas. I went overseas on the Queen Mary. And the Queen Mary would travel between the United States and Scotland because you couldn't land anywhere else in Europe.
Right.
It was too shallow.
Right.
And the ports were not proper for it. So one time, and the only time when I went overseas, I didn't come back. But the time that I went overseas, I was the only one without any troops. I didn't have any commando troops. I was born for a special purpose. And there was a service group made up of singers and bandmen and everything, singers and all kinds of. And they didn't have anybody as officers in charge. So one day the loudspeaker on the ship gave my name and asked me to come to the office on the ship. And they said, we don't have any commanding officer for this service company. Would you be willing to be the officer? And I said, yeah, I don't have anything to do. I'll be willing to. So I was. But I had I had Miller, for example, that went over the channel there and came down. Somebody shot him down.
Yeah.
He was a member of it. And I had, some of you people probably remember Bobby Breen.
Yeah.
You remember Bobby Breen, the tenor?
The singer.
Mm-hmm. The singer. I had him under my wing. And I had, above all else, Mickey Rooney. And Mickey Rooney was giving me the time of my life, I'm telling you. Every hour or so, during the daytime, the loudspeaker on the ship would say, Mickey Rooney, report to your commanding officer. That was me. And the reason for his having to report to me was because he didn't go to KP. He was supposed to wash the dishes, and he didn't go.
When I came home from, after the war was over, I came home on the USS Monticello from to the Mediterranean, and there was 7,000 people on that boat. We had the officers had one whole deck. They were the personnel for two field hospitals. And food hadn't been very good, but it was over there in the infantry. So when I got on the boat, the first thing I did was go down and volunteer for KP in the officer's mess.
Yeah, any other questions or comments from the audience or anybody from the panel? Anybody else got anything to say? I think we've, in a short time, we've covered a lot of ground here, and I express my appreciation to everybody for helping and making this such a good meeting. Thank you very much.
what he had written in shorthand, and it was quite interesting. There was, and I thought you would be interested to know that according to him, it's the Civil War, and he said that he complained of bugs and worms in the bread, and he wrote of going into deserted sugar houses to look for coffee sweetener and food. There were strict rules about stealing that were not always enforced. And if the men came across a field of watermelons, they helped themselves. And then the other one, you'll think I'm stuck on Vermont, I just happen to have it. And this man, his grandfather, he said that what he had for food was that he had pork and beans for breakfast, and bean and porks for dinner, and pork and beans for supper. And they weren't supposed to forage or steal any property off the country either. But they thought it'd be kind of nice if they got hold of this turkey that they knew was just not too far away from them. And so the drummer went over to the farmyard in full uniform with his drum, and he cut the bottom of the drum, and he came back with the turkey, and they had a turkey meal. And another thing, they weren't supposed to take the rail, you know, they had to put, at that time in the Civil War, they were cooking outdoors, and they were using wood, and the wood was scarce down there in the South. And so they weren't supposed to take the rails, only the top rail off the fence, and leave those other two rails. So what they did was, if they go along and they took the top rail off the fence, and then the next day, they kept in the top rail, and they took that off. And then they went along, and finally, the last rail was on the ground, but that was the top rail, so they took that too. Now, you know that our country is really trying to do things for the soldiers. And I never do, and I don't probably think that many of you know, that we have a man working right down outside of Boston, and it's called the Army Soldiers System Command. And he has about 60 people working for him. They're scientists, food technologists, and nutritionists. And they're working on trying to get better food for the soldiers, because they, as you know, they're not too crazy about those meals ready to eat. But they have improved some, so that now they have pork chops, they have chicken strips, and they have pasta. And they have one thing that is really good, and that's pound cake. And when this man was interviewing him, he was eating some pound cake, and they have four different kinds of it. And he said it was 4 years old, but it was still delicious. But now, with those meals that are ready to eat, they're coming in a bag, and they have to punch the bag, and then they have to get another bag and put their food in that bag, and then put in water, and then the chemical will do it. And that's the way they heat it. But now they've got a new plan, which they have, the food is in a bag, paper bag, and all you do is you just take a tab off, and it instantly heats, the water starts to heat, the chemical heats the water, and in 15 minutes or so, you have a hot food. They call it shim, and they don't know, but they haven't put it in yet. And I forgot to tell you that the latest thing they've added to the meals ready to eat is a little bottle of Tabasco. I thought that was it. Then Bill talked about this, and it was in 1936 that a man named Mr. Hormel invented a food that he called Spam. But the funny thing is that some people thought it was made of odds and ends, but it never has been, and it always is. It's still made of pure ham and pork shoulder. And then 1 ounce of it doesn't have as much fat in it as 1 ounce of peanut butter. But in 1941, we went to war, and they made 15 million cans of Spam a week. Imagine. But today, we still are eating Spam all over the world, and they average about 3 and 8 tins cans each second. Imagine. And it was interesting to me because when I was going to have to find, you don't have to get that. when I went in the store and I'm picking out this family, this woman came along with her husband and she took two cans. Okay.